We have some questions coming from the Q&A function from the live stream, and there's one question addressed to all. Maybe we can pick one or two of our experts who would like to answer that. And the question goes, do speakers think that consumers should just accept uninvited chemicals in their bodies if they are below the guidance level? So should we just live with a certain level of substances and uninvited chemicals?
So could you understand the question? Should we live with chemicals in the body? What do you think? I will pass this. I think Koki Takagi, maybe? What would you say?
Is it about the risk communications?
Well, we can't ask the author of this question, but I think the idea is that since it's such a difficult task, the human biomonitoring is such a difficult task with so many aspects and combinations and influences, should consumers just accept that they are exposed and that they live with uninvited chemicals?
Yeah. In our project, we please go ahead.
If you want, no, Gret wanted to answer something.
Well, I think there are two ways. First of all, this is a message for research, of course, that we have to really go into the research on how to combine exposures from different levels, chemicals from different sources. So it's really a call, I think, upon going further into that direction. On the other hand, what we do is we also always, like, for example, in studies with where pregnant mothers are involved, I think we can really try to advise people that to avoid exposures to complex to products where there are a lot of chemicals involved. So I think this is something we can already now do to alert people that they also themselves can protect a little bit themselves by choosing. On the other hand, society has also a big responsibility to make sure that the levels which are in the products are really safe. And I think this calls upon not only the scientists to work on complex exposure, but also the authorities to look over their silos and to really look into what comes in from consumers or products or from the environment, mm-hmm. that we all look at the whole exposures as the global thing.
Okay.
So things to do with respect consumers' behavior, but also scientists and authorities, I think, have to take this up very seriously.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you, Fred. I have another question to our guest here. And it's from Michael Schümann from Hamburg, and he asked to Teve Stralau, has the knowledge base for the glyphosate kinetics in humans has evolved over the use of some monkey data? So means, do we have, instead of monkey data, already human data for glyphosate?
For glyphosate, we do indeed have human data. And that's basically a basis for lots of the studies that were evaluated and presented. But I should add that glyphosate is an exception here, because it's really one of those few substances that is so data rich that you have a free choice of data. If I can extend the question basically to, do we have enough data in terms of biokinetics for every single chemical that we are looking at, then I, as a toxicologist, would say no, because that's really a sore issue, that for many substances we would like to have better kinetic data, but then of course you would basically extend the testing and the framework of testing to such an extent that it is hardly maintainable anymore. So for most data where you assess fresh chemicals, you rely on the animal data you have, and there's a certain aspect of biokinetics in there. You don't have extended biokinetic study. For some substances, you of course have human data, but then we should keep in mind that human data will only be available normally for substances that are already in circulation.
Because yeah, I think it's a special question concerning the glyphosate. So the risk assessment that you did or that you introduced was based on human data.
So basically those are human data and we wouldn't use monkey data anyway. It would be right.
Okay, thank you.
I have a question here addressed to Professor Gabriele Leng. Maybe we could provide her with a microphone, and there is another question from the auditorium for later. The gentleman on the right-hand side. Professor Leng, Dr. Bernd Herber would like to know, is it possible to work out liver microsome metabolism studies with human liver cells in case of CMR substances to find out the metabolism path in humans? And I'm very grateful for a very short answer.
Yes, you will get one. Well, we involve this kind of metabolism scheme in our studies, but there's only one problem. You will know that there is a metabolism, but it does not help to know which exact metabolites you want to measure. So it's fine, but it does not help for substituting the metabolism study. Thanks.
Thank you very much.
So now I have the microphone again. There's another question for in the audience. Okay,
My name is Florian Schulze from the European Center for Environmental Medicine. I have a question to Gret Schulters. She presented earlier that you established occupational level thresholds for certain substances. So will you elaborate further thresholds or reference levels for the general population? And in this case, how will you tackle this mixtures, the combination of several substances? As we know, for example, for a combination from mercury and lead, there are synergetic effects which increase the toxicology by the toxicological effect by 100. So will you include this? Probably the next speaker will also talk about these mixtures. How will you establish safe levels in this regard?
Thank you for this question. This is indeed a challenge. First of all, we derive in HBM4U HBM guidance values for the general population, and if we can also for workers. It depends a little bit on the information which is available in toxicological database, whether we can derive HBM guidance values for workers. For some compounds, it's not yet possible. With your question regarding the mixtures, we are fully aware that it is important, and we are planning to do some to try to derive some HBM guidance values, at least for phthalate mixtures. That's on our program. Maybe also for the isocyanides. So we will organize a workshop with experts also from outside the consortium to discuss about the possibilities and the way towards it. That's in the plan, but we still have to work on it. So it's not finalized, or it's work in progress.
Okay, thank you very much, Fred. I have a last question from Martin Wieske. It's for all, but I think I will ask this to Annie Santamon. How do we validate HBM guidance values? It's a question about validation. Do we need it, and how could we do it?
Yes, for sure. For us, as I mentioned, we work through, there was a working group that was reviewing all of the derivation. And then it's also peer reviewed because it's published in the literature.
Mm-hmm.
So I think this is our process for peer reviewing, and we think that's there were two levels, one at Health Canada and one outside of Health Canada in the peer review literature.
Okay, so maybe it's finished, time over. Okay, I get the sign. I thank you, all of you, for coming and for talking and for introducing your human bunny biomonitoring projects and talking about risk assessment and health-based guidance values, risk communication.